She is a woman of substance who got various compliments, like with her enthusiasm, she can bring back to life a dinosaur. She's embodied with various USPs like outstanding communication, very easy, empowering people, result-oriented, creative decision maker with over 20 years of experience working with international organizations, businesses, and NGOs. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, put your hands together to welcome this elegant and sorted woman, Irena Komitova.
Thank you. Thank you for such a lovely introduction. You know, when you said elegant, and I stood up a little bit to live to your promise.
Irena, we truly appreciate you taking out time for us, as well as joining us today for having this brief conversation. So I have so many questions which I believe would be able to give a little insight into your work to all our viewers. So I'm starting off this conversation with my first question. I want to know, how do you see your current role of being aligned, you know, being aligned with your values?
Well, let's put it like that. My values are that I want to give a lot, you know, because I believe giving makes you more powerful than getting back. So what do I give? I try to give knowledge. And this was from my very early age, because my parents were kind of professors and teachers. I've been looking up at them teaching other people. So I want to be like them. So I want to teach people. Okay. And then I also want to empower them, or to make them more enthusiastic about things they really care about. Yeah. Now, the second value is, might not be a value, I love luxury, okay? I adore luxurious thinking, creativity, working, but now what I do is also related to luxury. Well, luxury has new dimensions these days, you know? So what we do now is that we produce bio dairy products that I consider a real luxury, because they're clean, they're pure, they're natural, very much tested. And we want to bring this authentic taste to the public through the teaching we do, TEDx events or other different kind of social events. And through the new understanding of luxury, we do Rukatka products.
Right. Wonderful. Wonderful. So, Irena, you know, one thing which amazes me a lot as an individual and as a woman, to see that you started off your journey, your professional journey, as being CEO of Oriflame. How tough it was for you to hold such a senior role as a very first step of your entrepreneurial or professional journey?
Well, it actually happened by chance. And this is a good lesson for all of us, that chance will very often come to all of us, and it's important to grab the moment.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, I was very unhappy just before getting the job at Oriflame. I was obviously jobless. I just divorced my first husband. I had a kid to take care of, and I had no place to live. Okay. You know, I had to find an apartment to rent, and I had no money. So I saw this advertisement in the newspaper saying that a well-respected consulting company is recruiting for a CEO of Oriflame. And at that time, this was 30 years ago, Oriflame was not the known name it is today. So then I read, okay, what is Oriflame? A cosmetic company. There was no internet, remember, at the time. So you couldn't Google, you couldn't find out what it is. And I said, well, cosmetics, how hard could that be for a woman? You know, we all understand cosmetics, we all use cosmetics. So I went to this interview with a 2-meter high Viking and he interviewed me, and he said, he started explaining what the company is doing. He said, oh, you know, we're doing direct sales, natural cosmetics, clean products, etc., etc. And I was kind of nodding my head. I had no idea what direct sales means, you know, but I showed confidence. So this is lesson number two. You know, it's important when you deal with people in the corporate world to show your confidence and to say, yes, I can do this. Yeah. You know, you inside, you know that you can do this. So this is how it started. He took me on a very special trip abroad. And then a lot of other people interviewed me. They liked me and they said, okay, this is our girl for Bulgaria. So this is how we opened Oriflame Bulgaria.
Wow.
But now, however, because you said I was lucky to have this as my first job, maybe my whole class in the English language school in Plovdiv was very lucky, because one of my classmates had his first job as a prime minister of Bulgaria. So, you know, maybe it was like a group of people who are destined to take leadership position at a certain different point in our country.
Right. Wonderful. Wonderful. And since you jumped from being an employee to entrepreneur, where you have various high positions, so what difference did you observe in these two journeys? You know, being an employee of someone and having your own venture and running it on your own. What differences? Yeah.
Well, a lot of people will probably tell you that the big difference is in the decision-making process. Hmm. When you are part of a corporate structure, there are rules who have been created before you join this structure.
Yes.
So you behave and you do things within these rules or within these frames. And sometimes a very simple decision can take days and weeks and months to be taken as a whole.
Right.
When you are on your own, when you are doing your business, you set up the rules and you know which decisions are of paramount importance, which decision have to be taken in 15 minutes on the spot or need more discussion. So this is the first rule. Yeah. The second big difference is when you are an employee, you have to listen to your bosses, right? Because it's kind of dangerous if you oppose them.
Yes.
And it's kind of really dangerous if you oppose them relentlessly.
Yes.
And I had a case like that in my position as general manager for the BMW importer in Bulgaria, where the owner of the business asked me to sign certain documents, which I did not agree with. And they were not, let's say, the least, I would say, were not ethical in my mind. So when I refused to sign these documents, he said, Irena, what are we going to do now? And I said, obviously, we will part ways, because you want me to do something that I totally disagree. Yeah. I am not going to do it, so you have to fire me.
Right.
And this is what he did. He fired me. Okay? Oh. So when you are an employee, you have to be ready to stand up to what you believe. And now that I run my own business, I find it very eye-opening to let my teammates bring up a controversial opinion, something that is opposite to my opinion, because this is the hardest thing for a boss, for an opinionated and successful boss, to say, oh, okay, I have been wrong. I see your point. Okay, let's go and do what you suggest. And you can do it even if you know it might be wrong, because if you take all the decisions for your teammates, you actually are not empowering them.
Right.
You know, you want them to be like, you know, do this, do that. And even if they're wrong, you discuss it later on. But if they are successful, when they bring an idea which is controversial to what you think, they feel so much happy. And they say, you see, I suggested this, I did this, I took the risk, and I get the rewards now. So this is another big difference.
You have to strike a good balance, you know, when you are an entrepreneur, you are having your own employees. And when you are someone's employee, stories are different. Here, I think it's challenging both ways, actually. I mean, nowhere we can escape from human relations and the challenges which are around human relations.
Be of course.
It workspaces. Whenever we are interacting with any human in our life, challenges are bound to happen. And I think this is inevitable.
Yeah, exactly. And actually, I have been thinking for a long time, but now with this situation, maybe next year, I really want to come. And the other thing, when you are an entrepreneur, for example, I have never been to India, yeah. You know, so it is on my to-do list, on my plans.
Yeah.
And when you are like that, you can say, oh, okay, I can go to Delhi, for example, next week.
Yeah.
Or three months from now. Yeah. So you are also free to work as hard as you want and as long as you want. Yes. And you're also free to travel when you want to travel or when it is the best time to travel. So from very early age, I would encourage girls who feel a leadership potential in themselves to start something of their own. It is so rewarding. You know, it is so liberating. It is so enriching. Maybe I should have started from the very beginning, but I didn't have the knowledge and the courage. So it comes with time, with experience. No one knows. I mean, no matter how many things you have done before, you can never be sure that you're going to be successful.
Yes.
You have to continue trying.
And I think this unpredictability of life keeps us moving, actually. If we know the result of everything ahead, probably we will not venture into something which we feel will not be productive. That's why life gives us experiences. You know, we burn our hands, but out of that experience also, we are learning something. That is teaching us next time when we are taking up some new project, what to do, what not to do. So I think that's how we evolve as an individual being, right? But as we know that you have been closely associated with projects like Women Empowerment, and you run various women-oriented communities also. What tangible results you have seen while running such communities vis-a-vis making them empowered as a woman?
Right now, in a month's time, we will be doing in Sofia TEDx women event, and the topic is fearless. So we will try to bring this quality in women to show that now is the time to risk and to take action. So the first tangible result when you work with so many women is that they feel they are a community, that they are very strong, that they can do everything, and they are ready to take action.
Yes.
I had challenged even from the Oriflame days and later on women to take part in charity causes and charity projects. And when you set a target, let's say 100,000 euro to raise for a certain charity, women are relentless. They go not only to achieve the target, but to surpass it, which is, you know, a real tangible result. The first modern children playgrounds, for example, have been built up in Bulgaria some 2 years ago, when the country was in a very big financial crisis, but women got together, raised the money, found the architects, did the designs, and built 5 children playgrounds in Sofia and Plovdiv.
Wow.
The second tangible result is when you challenge women to show their creative potential. Because of old ages, a little bit of competition between women, when they start doing a thing together, yeah. Each one tries to show her creation, her project, her design, you know, and it goes better and better and better. And this brings a very good feeling of fulfillment to everyone who participates. I had challenged like that about 16 very wealthy and very high level women in Bulgaria to participate in a drawing exercise, teaching exercise. Each one of us did a painting, and the one class was following Claude Monet technique, and the other class was doing things with scissors and like panels, etc. So at the end we had 16 very nice drawings, mm-hmm. and we did a charity auction for these drawings to support SOS Kinderdorf in Bulgaria. And for example, just think of yourself and of me, you know, we take a piece of paper, we draw something, and then it is being sold for 3,000 euro. It's outrageous. You can never believe this, you know. None of us is a professional artist, but it was so empowering and so extraordinary to be able to see that people care because you care.
Right.
So this is what I've seen. Bringing women together, they always want to give back to society, and they give to causes related to children, to education, to arts, to greening the cities, you know, to something that is really close to their heart.
Wonderful. And since you are such an experienced woman, I will not end this interview without taking your advice for all our viewers. So please, if you have any word of wisdom, please share that with all our women viewers.
I will, although it's very difficult to be followed. And you'll understand in a moment why. My wisdom and my thinking goes like that. Be good to other people and to the world. Yeah. It is so much better to be good than to be nervous, than to frown, than to shout, than to impose penalties or anything like that. But it is very challenging, because if you have 100 emails per day to answer, 50 phone calls, I don't know how many Zoom meetings or team meetings, etc. Yeah. At the end of the day, you say, okay, so where I am?
Yes.
Where am I? You know, I need to something for myself. So first start being good with yourself. Mm. You need your personal time. You need to look good. You need to have lipstick. Yeah, you see, I don't. You need to wear a little bit of makeup, dress up, even if you don't go out, and, dress up for yourself.
Feel good factor, yeah.
Yeah. So feel good, then you will be good to other people.
Great.
But it's difficult, you know.
But at least we can try. We should.
Yes. Yeah, I think we can try.
On that note, ma'am, we would love to thank you from our bottom of heart, and thank you so much for having such a lovely, insightful conversation with us. We wish you all the best for your all future endeavors and projects. So thank you so much.
It was a pleasure.
Thank you so much once again for being with us and enlightening us.
It was a pleasure. Thank you, Rajni.
Thank you guys for watching. Take care and see you.
good luck. So